The Oregon Ducks women's basketball team just wrapped up a fantastic regular season by finishing conference play 16-2, claiming sole ownership of the 2017-2018 Pac-12 Women's Basketball Regular Season Conference Championship. For a team that finished 9th in the conference 4 years ago, and only 6th place the last 2 seasons in a row, the incredible turnaround belongs to the exceptionally talented roster recruited by head coach Kelly Graves. As the best team in the conference, Oregon fans have been treated to spectacular play that Coach Graves appropriately referred to as a symphony. One that features many moving parts, all seamlessly working together to produce show-stopping basketball. Join me as we preview the Pac-12 Conference Tournament in Seattle by looking at 10 players that boosted Oregon to the top of the conference. This is Episode 1 of The Symphony. Five-foot-ten guard Justine Hall is only one of 2 seniors who the team bids farewell to after this season. Despite averaging only 5 minutes per game, Hall finds her way onto the floor almost every game. Just recently against Arizona, Hall recorded a three-pointer, a rebound, an assist, and 2 steals over 12 minutes. Hall has knocked down 3 of her last 5 three-point attempts. If she finds herself on a hot streak, a player like Hall suddenly demanding attention from the defense can spark the entire offense. Despite remaining quiet in the box scores, Hall's best games of the season might just be ahead of her.
I just love you guys so much, and playing with you has been so amazing, and you guys are great.
5'9" guard Aina Ayuso is a freshman out of Spain who also played 5 minutes per game. In her brief appearances on the floor, Ayuso accounted for a fair share of highlight plays and showed flashes of being a dynamic point guard like fellow Spaniard Maite Cazorla. Ayuso also features a nice three-point shot, landing 5 of her last 9 shots from outside the arc. Ayuso has only scored 2 points in her last 5 games, but the tape shows her highlight reel potential. As a 6'2" freshman out of Melbourne, Australia, Annalie Maley offers a unique brand of physicality and hustle from the guard position. Maley averaged 9 minutes per game, but over the last 5 games, those minutes have fallen to 4 minutes per game. Maley has an instinct and aggressive play style that can't be taught. Combine this with her size, and Maley wins a fair share of loose ball and rebound battles. Maley typically has little impact on the other end of the ball, but one standout performance against California shows us her potential. Against the Cal Bears, Maley went 3-for-4 from behind the arc and snagged 4 rebounds. Maley has only 3 points in the last 7 games, so her 9 points against Cal was a career high. The potential to space the floor with a hot hand gives Maley a chance to be a game-changing offensive weapon. Those 3 players from 3 different countries might see their minutes reduced in the postseason, but all 3 of them hope to make big impact plays.
On top of the bench, Oregon's gone on a big run.
Wow. Audie Gilden only stands 6'1", but she spends most of her time battling in the paint and providing much needed relief for the other bigs on the team. Gilden averages 13 minutes per game, and her stats from the last 3 weeks shine light on her consistency. In the last 6 games, Gilden has averaged 4 rebounds, 1 assist, and 1 steal per game, as well as shooting 10 for 17 with 9 out of 12 from the free throw line. Gilden might not have many highlight plays, but she fills up the stat sheet and quietly provides quality minutes. Now that we're looking at players who spend significantly more time on the floor, we're going to look at what an off game looks like for most players. An off game for Gilden means little offensive production, passing the ball almost as soon as she gets it, as well as getting dominated by bigger forwards on the other side of the ball. Steady production and being involved on both sides of the ball is crucial for Gilden in the postseason. Otherwise, the team will need to stretch the minutes of the other bigs. Standing at 6'5", Mallory McGuire is a sophomore who will enter the postseason as Oregon's first option off the bench. McGuire played 18 minutes per game, and besides the obvious benefit of being the largest one on the floor, McGuire has 2 primary weapons on the offensive end. One is the offensive rebound followed by a layup. Another tool McGuire has used frequently is a beautiful jump shot from the free throw line. Mallory is always looking to knock down those long two-pointers and space the defense out, creating more room in the paint. McGuire uses that combination to sport an impressive 50% shooting percentage along with 4.5 points per game. At her best, McGuire is making crucial shots and playing solid defense. At her worst, McGuire is unable to create shots on offense and racking up fouls on the defensive end. While the star power might earn the accolades, McGuire and Gilden spend a lot of time on the floor and have a dramatic impact on the team's efficiency. 5'9", Eugene native Lexi Bando is a four-year starting guard that has seen the growth of the program and will leave an NCAA legacy of prolific three-point shooting prowess. Bando was sidelined for half of conference play, returning from injury for the last 5 games of the season. Bando's three-pointer remains at the top of the conference. Shooting 13 for 25 over the last 5 games, the Oregon offense is elevated to another level by Bando's 50% three-point percentage. The most telling story of Bando's patience with the program is the biannual Civil War rivalry matchup against Oregon State. In what is often the most important basketball game of the year, Bando has seen Oregon lose 7 consecutive Civil War matchups before finally winning in what could be Lexi's final Civil War. The passion and the fire inside Bando makes her the heart of a program despite being overshadowed on the national stage by her teammates' star power. The Bando bounce has become synonymous with the magic of this Oregon roster.
7 from the floor, back out, Bando! Money! Did I mention? They don't get discouraged about missing threes. Lexi Bando could roll out of bed at 5 in the morning, go out in the snow and knock them down.
I think she does, actually.
Due to only playing 11 conference games, Bando misses the cutoff to be ranked in the Pac-12 conference leaderboards, but her incredible 2.7 three-pointers made per game would rank her 2nd in the conference, alongside a conference-leading 48% three-point percentage. This combination of efficiency and frequency makes Bando the best shot from range in the conference. At her best, Bando takes over games with clutch three-pointers. At her worst, Bando is a one-trick pony with an abysmal 22% shooting percentage on two-point shots, as well as only 2 rebounds and 0.5 assists per game. With Lexi playing her final games of her Oregon career, the Ducks' flair for late-game magic means we'll likely see another Bando
11
bounce.
11 on the shot clock. Ionescu looking for the high pick.
8, 7, 6. Keeps the dribble alive.
8, 7. Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? I have never seen a three-point shot drop like that. Holy smokes!
Wow! Have you ever seen a three-pointer go down like that? No, but that is tremendous shooter's touch.
6'4" freshman from Berlin, Germany, Satu Sabali has made a splash in her first year on campus, winning Pac-12 Freshman of the Year. Making her way into the starting lineup, Sabali flashes the potential to be an elite scorer in the future. Her average of 10 points per game, third highest among Pac-12 freshmen, is mostly thanks to her ability to make difficult shots near the basket. Whether it's a breakaway layup or a beautiful fadeaway shot while being fouled, Sabali has a unique frame that makes her difficult to guard and versatile. Sabali shoots 50% on her two-point baskets and combines that with a developing three-point shot. Sabali missed at least 3 three-point shots in 8 of her last 18 games, along with a 32% three-point percentage. Despite having a statistically weak three-point shot, it's important that she keeps launching open three-pointers. Recently, in a crucial matchup against UCLA, Sabali carried the offense on her back with a 25-point performance, powered by a career-high 7-for-9 from 3. This versatility on the offense, along with 2 assists per game, makes Sabali a dynamic freshman with tremendous potential. Sabali makes an impact on the other side of the court as well, with 4 rebounds, 1 steal, and 0.7 blocks per game. At her best, Satu Sabali shines on both sides of the floor, making huge baskets and lifting the offense as one of the 5 members of the Pac-12 All-Freshman team. At her worst, Sabaly is an ineffective passer who misses too many shots and then quietly fades into the background of a game, making minimal impacts. The ability for Satu, as well as other teammates, to knock down those open three-point shots is crucial to the Symphony. Time.
There's the pick. Look at the spin. Oh, baby! Sabaly!
Overshadowed by some of the best sophomore talents the entire NCAA has to offer, 5'10" Spanish guard Maite Cazorla has quietly been one of the best players in the conference. She is a textbook point guard, calling plays on both sides of the ball as well as guarding the other team's points all the way up and down the floor. For starters, Cazorla is the best defender on the team, averaging 2 rebounds and 1.4 steals per game. The stats may not be clear, but Cazorla battling on the defensive side of the ball is like a junkyard dog, disrupting the other team and always forcing turnovers. Cazorla received an honorable mention for the Pac-12 All-Defense Team. Not only was Cazorla a hound on defense, but also a workhorse, finding herself in the top 10 in the conference for total minutes played. Earning one of the 15 spots on the All-Pac-12 team, Cazorla did more than just play defense, dishing out 4.7 assists per game, good enough to rank top 8 in the conference in both assists and assist turnover ratio. Cazorla is just another Oregon Duck with a killer 3-point shot. Cazorla bangs home open 3-pointers with ease and is confident enough to land difficult contested 3-point shots as well. Cazorla averages 2 threes per game and is one of only 7 players in the conference to do so, along with a great 40% 3-point percentage that ranks top 15 in the conference. If you give Cazorla any chance to cut straight to the basket and grab a layup, she will fly right past you and pick up those easy points. This penchant for making tough layups gives Cazorla another weapon on offense. To go with excellent 3-point shooting, an incredible 24-for-26 stat line on free throws, Cazorla also scores 55.6% of her 2-point shots. This incredible shooting percentage also ranks top 10 in the country. All of these offensive weapons give Cazorla 12 points a game, good enough for top 25 in the conference. At her best, Cazorla plays great defense, makes great passes, and has the potential for a game-changing, explosive performance in the scoring department as well. At her worst, she has a rough shooting night and can't contribute much of anything on offense besides a few assists, forcing some of the other role players below her to step up. Watch for Maite Cazorla to play big minutes and make some big shots during Oregon's postseason. 6'4" sophomore forward Ruthie Hebert is part of the two-headed monster that is Oregon's offense. Hebert is the most efficient point scorer in the conference, with a conference-leading 67.6 field goal percentage. Hebert has a wide array of post moves that makes her so difficult to stop, scoring at will and making a mind-blowing amount of contested shots as well as easy layups off of the back of great passes from her teammates. Hebert is a double-double monster, picking up 19.4 points and 8.6 rebounds per game. Not only is Hebert making 2 out of every 3 shots, but over the last 3 weeks, Hebert has played even better than those statistics, averaging 23 points per game with a mind-blowing 80% field goal percentage. Hebert is also a force on the defensive end, averaging 1 steal and 1.4 blocks per game. At her best, Ruthie Hebert is a two-way star who spends an entire quarter, sometimes an entire game, and sometimes an entire weekend as the undisputed most dominant player on the court. As a top 5 rebounder and top 5 point scorer, Ruthie Hebert is one of the 4 sophomores on the All-Pac-12 team. At her worst, Hebert has great consistency with at least 10 points in 17 of 18 games and at least 6 rebounds in 17 of 18 games. One concern with Hebert is sometimes her defense lags behind and she sees herself outperformed by the opposing forward. Players such as Marie Gulich, Brittany McPhee, and Monique Billings will go against Hebert in the postseason, and they all have the potential to outshine Ruthie as they have done in the past. Regardless, Hebert is an outstanding star player and a crucial part of the Symphony. This incredible cast of players features 2 All-Pac-12 selections, the best 3-point shooter in the conference, the best freshman in the conference, and numerous talented role players ready to shine. This would surely make an excellent roster that would win a lot of games, but imagine taking all these players and adding the single best basketball player in the Pac-12. That's right, 5'11" sophomore guard out of Walnut Creek, affectionately known as Super Sabrina, Miss Triple-Double, and Sabron, your Pac-12 Player of the Year, your NC2A career triple-double leader, Sabrina Ionescu is more than just the cherry on top. Ionescu hustles on the defensive end, not afraid to get physical and not afraid to chase rebounds. For someone of her height, Ionescu grabs an incredible 6.8 rebounds per game, putting her 12th in the conference. Ionescu sits third in the Pac-12 in minutes played. Sabrina Ionescu is nothing short of magical with the ball in her hands. Using her acute awareness of everything happening around her, Ionescu always takes what the defense gives her. Always. Reverse layup? She can make it. Floaters and other creative paint moves? She's got plenty of those. Random pull-up jumpers and heavy traffic? Apparently those are easy. Open three-pointers? Seriously, why did you leave her open? Contested NBA threes that she just decides to jack up every once in a while? Oh, she makes most of those. Being able to score most anywhere on the floor powers Sabrina Ionescu to 20.1 points per game, second in the conference. Sabrina scores 39% of her points from three-point land, knocking down 2.6 three-point field goals per game, good for second place in the Pac-12. In half of her conference games, Sabrina scored at least 3 3-point baskets, and her 40% three-point percentage lands her at 12th in the conference. 38% of Sabrina's points have come from those crazy pull-up jumpers and layups we talked about. Sabrina has a solid 48% field goal percentage on two-point shots. Sabrina also makes her way to the free throw line often, with an incredible 23% of her offensive production coming from free throws. Ionescu's 82% free throw percentage puts her third in the Pac-12. The most dynamic and versatile shooter in the conference also adopts a pass-first mentality and has amazing court vision to set up teammates with easy buckets. Ionescu leads the conference with 7.7 assists per game, as well as a top 5 assist-turnover ratio. One of the 10 semifinalists for NCAA Player of the Year in her sophomore year, with an average game consisting of 20 points, 8 assists, and 7 rebounds. Yes, that incredible stat line would be another day at the office for Ionescu. While mostly scrapping it out for difficult shots and looking to make sharp passes, Sabrina is at her best for brief flashes during games where she is by all means untouchable. Whether it's scoring more than 10 in a quarter or going huge in the last minutes of a game as well as overtime, Ionescu sometimes just flips a switch and buries every single shot she attempts. At her worst, Ionescu gets frustrated by off nights from her teammates and flails around, taking dumb shots and missing quite a few. As much as the triple-double queen likes to steal the show, she looks like a completely different player when her teammates don't give her enough help and she tries to do everything by herself. Sabrina missed at least 10 shots in 7 different games during conference play, 2 of those being their only losses to Stanford and Oregon State. Sabrina might be the star of the symphony, but the music always sounds best with the whole orchestra hitting every note behind her.
Got another triple-double here!
There you have it, Pac-12 conference champs, the best home attendance in the conference, a number one seed in the Pac-12 tournament, and a likely number one or number two seed in the NCAA tournament as well. Oregon women's basketball sits at the top of the world, but the real season has only just begun. On Friday, they open the Pac-12 tournament against Colorado or Utah, two middle-of-the-road squads that will put up a fight, but need to catch the Ducks on a bad shooting night or they will lose by about 15. The semifinals on Saturday night will likely feature Oregon against UCLA for the third time. The Ducks beat the Bruins on the road in a low-scoring battle and then miraculously snuck past the Bruins at home in one of their best shooting nights of the season. Powered by superstar seniors Jordan Canada and Monique Billings, UCLA definitely has the star power to keep up with Oregon. coach, and the Ducks would probably need some magic to take out UCLA for the third time this season. That massive victory won't even win them the tournament. They'll move on to a Sunday final matchup against probably Stanford or Oregon State. These two squads are Oregon's last two losses, and the Ducks have to play to their full potential to clinch the postseason title. The number one seeded Ducks should be the favorites to win the Pac-12 tournament, but with so much competition, Oregon is going to need to play their best basketball and have some incredible performances this weekend to take out top 25 squads in back-to-back games. Looking forward to the great basketball ahead, I'm Michael Streit, and this is the Symphony.
Someday somebody's gonna make you wanna turn around and say goodbye.